They are the chosen ones, the ones who've inherited their present on a dynastic platter. All they have to do was to take a winning legacy forward. But by the looks of it, these young inheritors are doing very little to live up to their legacies, to nurture their political narrative and take it forward.
Hello and welcome to Cover Story. This week we are going to be taking a look at three young political dynasts and also examine how they squandered their political legacy. The first, of course, is Rahul Gandhi, who continues to be a perpetual work in progress. The other is Omar Abdullah. He is the third generation Abdullah to rule the state of Jammu and Kashmir, but the way he's been handling the state, he may well end up being the last Abdullah to rule the state. And finally is Akhilesh Yadav, who came in on a promise of difference, but has ended up being just a remote control for his father.
All three are young, Western-educated professionals, and at least two of them seem to be reluctant politicians. Perhaps they should have stuck to the profession of their choice, for it does seem that politics is not the natural calling. In fact, Rahul Gandhi has always come across as an heir not apparent. He was the face of the Congress Party's disastrous 2014 campaign as a star campaigner, along with his mother and mentor, the Congress President Sonia Gandhi. But even though the enormity of the defeat shocked congressmen, what really damaged party morale was Rahul's attitude in the aftermath of defeat. There was no attempt to reach out and reassure his colleagues, and neither has there been any attempt to lead.
See, I have said that we all wanted Mr. Rahul Gandhi to become the leader of the parliamentary party in Congress, in Lok Sabha. But he has always been a person who does not go for power. He's not power hungry.
Please seriously ponder as to how your party got reduced to 44, the lowest ever in your history. That's for you to ponder, where you were the face of the campaign. That's the first thing I'd like to tell him. And the second, when he's saying Narendra Modi has asked to control corruption, there is no case of corruption in our government. Yes, we are suffering legacy problem of Mr. Rahul Gandhi's government that we are setting right, from coal block to everything.
He was always a reluctant handler of his legacy. Unlike others who are born with a political platter on their heads, Rahul, I think, from the very beginning showed a greater reluctance than others. Has that resulted in his squandering away his inheritance? I think in terms of electoral results, certainly. In terms of the responses of the party faithful, even more. He hasn't actually wandered too far away from what could be defined in a kind of nebulous sense as Congress ideology. You know, the pro-poor, the pro-minority.
The winter session of Parliament has seen Rahul Gandhi finally get down to the trenches and take on the opposition. Keeping Delhi polls in mind, he went late one evening and protested against the demolition of a South Delhi slum.
Congress party yahan pe garibon ki ladai ladegi. और यहाँ पे जो हो रहा है बिल्कुल गलत हो रहा है और इसके खिलाफ कांग्रेस पार्टी हर इंच पे लड़ेगी. हम छोड़ने वाले नहीं है.
गरीबों की लड़ाई लड़ रहा है वो. मोदी कहते
हैं सही ठीक है, मगर बुलडोजर मेरे शरीर के ऊपर से निकलेगा.
He is trying to, I think, still come to terms with his legacy. He accepts in private conversation, he accepts that he has a very heavy burden to carry, but he wants to have everyone share that legacy. He accepts in private conversation, he accepts that he has a very heavy burden to carry, but he wants to have everyone share that legacy. He doesn't want to monopolize it. And which is why he's done this, he embarked on this program of restructuring the party. But restructuring the party is something that's the easy way out. I think you still have to fight in the trenches, you still have to undertake road battles, you still have to be sensitive to what the other side is saying about you, what you are saying about your party and so on. So I feel a bit sorry for him because he has to fight on many fronts. But I think it's clear that the Congress, in order to stay alive and fight another day, has to reinvent itself. it cannot go on peddling the same slogans, and above all, it cannot be a party which is inventing itself for the purpose of coming to power in 5 years. The Congress idea has to be reinvented.
Inside Parliament too, Rahul did try and win back the opposition space from the TMC. He joined the protest organized by the opposition against the government, even making the sartorial concession of wearing a black band in Parliament.
The thing is, I'm not seeing a pattern here. It's just random actions, which, I mean, are fine, but they don't leave any lasting impression on public memory. So I think we need some kind of a decisive intervention, some kind of a blueprint being rolled out, some sort of... if people ask you, why are you here? You need to be able to answer that question. I don't think he's ready to answer that question yet.
हम सबको एक साथ लेके चलते हैं, हिंदू, मुसलमान, सिख, ईसाई.
Hopeful congressmen see this as a sign that the young leader was finally taking his responsibility seriously. But privately, they are also skeptical that this may be yet another bout of the hit and run brand of leadership that Rahul Gandhi is so fond of displaying. Has Rahul heard the murmurs of discontent that are doing the rounds in Congress anterooms? Some point to his NGO style of leadership that has alienated the aspirational middle class. Others talk about his coterie of young laptop-toting professionals mixed with a bunch of Congress leaders who have long passed their sell-by date. These include Madhusudan Mistry, Mohan Prakash, Beni Prasad Varma and Jairam Ramesh. There is, however, talk of an organizational revamp, but 6 months after the Lok Sabha defeat, it is all talk and no action.
Well, in business, they say that dynastic businesses do not last more than 3 generations, because the first generation builds, the second consolidates and expands, and the third fritters it away. And right at this moment, we are seeing those examples. In fact, we are seeing examples of second generation fritting away. Because many don't change with the times. The Congress is a perfect example. The old guard just refuses to get out of the way. And it happens with most organizations. Dynasty is just the manifestation. And in fact, it will happen with these regional outfits also.
Omar is the third generation Abdullah Chief Minister of the state. And it could be argued that he walked on a bed of golden leaves to achieve this legacy. Because the last elections were really fought on the promise that Farooq Abdullah would be Chief Minister. But once the results came in, Omar and his best buddy Rahul decided that instead, Omar would get the job. But that's not the unfortunate part. The unfortunate part is, having got the job, Omar has done really very little to deliver. For one, he couldn't make the same emotional connect as his father did with the people in the valley. And in the coming elections, if he doesn't win, then the Abdullahs could be as rare a political entity as the Jinko Bilwoba tree behind me.
Omar Abdullah came as a new idea, but unfortunately he botched it up too soon. He perhaps thought that his family legacy would carry him through, and that evaporated in the very first year of his rule. But then he never tried to reach out to the people. He in fact looked for those lifelines from Delhi, which came from Rahul Gandhi mainly. In 2010, when so many young people got killed in Kashmir in street protests, it was Rahul Gandhi who came out and said, no, we need to give time to this young man. And then from one crisis to another, he hurtled himself.
Will Omar be the last Abdullah? For the sitting chief minister, it is indeed a tough ride against the expectations of the people. Apart from the usual anti-incumbency, Omar is also facing charges of a detached rule with too many trips to New Delhi. When he did finally do a mid-course correction, it was too late, as he had already been labelled as an absentee landlord in the minds of the people.
Omar Abdullah is a Rahul Gandhi of J&K state. He probably went on a wrong pitch, because when you get anything in your family, hierarchies, you don't respect that what you have got. And that is what people are talking. They want to end the family rules here. I can very surely say that in this elections, Congress is out, National Conference is out. Let's not debate about them, of their you know, coming to power.
Umar Abdullah basically never related himself with this place, because this place has a special, you need to be a person who has been brought up, who has studied here, who belongs to this place, who understands the nuances, who understands the culture. Unfortunately, he has none of those attributes. He came here like someone would come, he would be, if a young recruit goes into the IAS, and then he's allotted Jammu and Kashmir cadre.
Omar hates it when he's called the Rahul Gandhi of JNK. But there are enough similarities between the two Western educated friends now turned political foes. It is also sad that the two together could do so little for this strife-torn state that is badly in need of a healing touch. They did get together and organize a high-profile investor conference, and while NC leaders say it created jobs, somehow that has not translated into goodwill on the ground for either Rahul or Omar.
A lot of jobs, thousands of jobs were created in the private sector. They were done through a scheme we launched, the Udaan scheme, the Himayat scheme. Around 40,000 youth from the state were given opportunities with corporate placements with a lot of corporate companies. And this was an arrangement between the government and the corporate companies where the government also pitched in.
Farooq, when you compare to his son, Farooq was more closely linked to his people, because whatever you call it, his rhetorics, theatrics, whatever, Farooq would go and sit, enter a village home, go to the hearth, tell the lady who was cooking rice there, pour some for me, and he would eat it. I have seen him do it. That is what is more important for a Kashmiri than the road you are building outside his home. Kashmir is a better off place than any other Indian state, developmentally. There are no homeless in Kashmir.
Farooq has a deep charm. And he was at one point of time man of the masses. If he enters any room in Kashmir, out of 10, he will at least know 5 people by name. But Omar Abdullah doesn't have that that advantage. He doesn't know anybody. He hasn't studied in Kashmir. He hasn't been brought up in Kashmir. He has not played in Kashmir. Perhaps he might not have walked any street in Kashmir.
Unlike his father, Omar seems to lack a natural connect with the people. It is not as if Farooq's chief ministership was the golden age in the valley. But somehow nostalgia and a reticent air has made the people of Kashmir long for the missing Abdullah, searching for both his father and his grandfather in Omar.
When Omar Abdullah was projected as chief minister candidate in 2002, he lost his own election. He could not win his seat. Then the National Conference changed the leadership. They said in their manifesto that this time we have requested Dr. Farooq Abdullah, he's come back and he will be our chief minister candidate. So the votes were given in the name of Dr. Farooq Abdullah, in the name of Ghulam Nabi Azad, and in the name of Mufti Muhammad Saeed. There were 3 chief ministerial candidates. So end of the day, you found a 4th person, paradropped from Delhi, to become the chief minister. So that was his, I think, first negative, which he hit. And the way, the shabby way he treated his father. And I think that also put off the people.
Even Umar's constituency, Gandharbal, from which he dumped and ran away, it has a central university, it has the best of roads, it has a huge hospital coming up, it has an administrative complex. What else did the people want there? You know, what matters in Kashmir, probably in the rest of India, that you would be knowing better than me, is how closely you are contact on ground with the people. That was a touch with Omar lost, with the people. He is probably a more Western educated. He believes in more social rectitude. It doesn't gel well. You have to come and sit with me on my paddy land and have my cup of tea. You may get influenza after that. You have to eat out of my hand. I will come and I will embrace you. An old lady will come and kiss your forehead. If you think this is going to be your next bout of influenza, that doesn't gel with Kashmir. This was Omar's problem.
And I won't be surprised if a few years from now, if the next government in, say, Jammu and Kashmir or elsewhere does poorly, people will say those were the days. Remember, even in Uttar Pradesh, there is a lot of fondness and memory for Mayawati's rule now. because of lack of her communal riots, for example. So, but at that time when she was ruling, everyone said, oh God, this is terrible and all that kind. So nostalgia is born out of selective memory.
Is not just an inheritor. If one looks at it carefully, he also usurped a certain part of what was the Abdullah legacy. I think the pace at which he took over was somewhat surprising, I suspect, even to his father. So while his father may have wanted to see a succession, probably the pace and the accelerator was stepped on by Omar himself. So is that normal, or is that par for the course for what could happen in an Abdullah dynasty? I think not. Omar's initial softness was belied by the speed and completeness of his control that he tried to take over.
Akhilesh Yadav rode a high wave of expectations to power when he became the country's youngest sitting chief minister. Waving laptops and a degree in environment engineering, he promised to make a difference. But the change that was in the air lasted only till his swearing-in. The magic ended the minute he swore in tainted ministers in his mammoth cabinet. It was not just the stage that collapsed for swearing-in when the unruly mob attacked the dais. It was also the expectations of the people of Uttar Pradesh. He soon proved that he was no more than his father's puppet.
If given opportunity to him to do whatever he wants, if he is allowed to create his own team, I'm not saying it will be very brilliant, but it will be nonetheless better than what it is. I will simply say that Akhilesh is sitting on chair, that's all. All the major decisions, I'm for sure that Madam Anita Singh will get it verified from father, and if Akhilesh will say that why it is happening, she may bluntly tell him, ask your father. So to work under such contradictions is just not possible.
Akhilesh's legacy is slightly more troubled. It's a shared legacy as opposed to both the other legacies that we've talked about. Both Rahul and Omar don't have shared legacies. Akhilesh's legacy is clearly a turf on which there is a stepbrother and there are a panoply of uncles. So I think it's a legacy and inheritance which he hasn't fully inherited. Worse, his father still believes in treating him as a remote.
Clearly, Akhilesh did not have it in him to break out of his father's stranglehold. As rapes and misgovernance mounted, Akhilesh has spent his chief ministership either defending his father's retrograde comments against women in general and rape victims in particular, or else being reprimanded by his father in public for his lackluster role.
So, सरकार के बारे में सुन लीजिए मुख्यमंत्री आके मोहचन ही नहीं करता पिछली सरकार ने लॉस किया उत्तर प्रदेश का और उसी वजह से बिजली नहीं लगी उस वक्त क्या अधिकारी बैठे बताए क्या नहीं ऐसा तो पिछली सरकार ने लॉस किया ये सरकार आदि तो रोजाना सोचे कि उत्तर प्रदेश का विकास कैसे हो क्योंकि उत्तर प्रदेश का विकास हिंदुस्तान का विकास है हिंदुस्तान का एक बड़ा क्षय है उत्तर प्रदेश के बिना महाशक्ति हिंदुस्तान ही बन सकता है ये जिम्मेदारी हमारी आप सबकी है इसलिए अपने अपने विभाग को तेजी से चलाइए और चापलूसी में मत फंसिए चापलूसी पसंद लोग हमेशा धोखा खाते हैं वो उनकी कभी इमेज अच्छी नहीं बनती है कि चापलूस पसंद होते
हैं He's got a shadow of his father, who is the chief of the party and who is probably making a statement a day. And he's still out there in his old years trying to put together a new party. So he's a shadow of his father, who is the chief of the party and who is probably making a statement a day. And he's still out there in his old years trying to put together a new party. So he's a very active politician. So he's got his father, he's got his father's old colleagues looking over his shoulder. And it's quite possible that even if he was a good politician, he couldn't do much.
The lavish and over-the-top birthday bash that Akhilesh threw for his father was simply the icing on the cake. A state reeling under power cuts, rapes and hooliganism certainly couldn't afford this party. But drunk on power, both father and son seemed to care less. They seem to have missed the warning of the Lok Sabha results, where the only seats they were able to save were the ones contested by the family. But taking heart from their four Mayawati's defeat, Akhilesh seems to think he has much to celebrate about.
And finally, there is the case of Uddhav Thackeray, who is yet another dynast who just couldn't deliver along the pressures of his dynasty. In fact, under him, the Sena has turned from a growling tiger to the BJP's pet cat. During the recent assembly elections, he just couldn't convince the people of Maharashtra to make him chief minister. And after that, he couldn't convince his allies to make him deputy chief minister.
Well, the times were very different. The father created this organization, tapped into a sense of disgruntlement among his constituents, Marathi speakers, built upon it. He was a tiger, yes, but he was a soft-spoken tiger in real life. He was not a bombastic kind of person, but he had the power to mesmerize his audiences, and the audiences were ready to follow. And it is a myth, sometimes people think that, you know, only Maharashtrians followed him. Even non-Maharashtrians have followed him, because he had this power to focus on what his message was. It was sometimes quite crude, but he had that power. Uddhav is sometimes looks like a reluctant tiger. He is soft-spoken, he would rather be there as a photographer. But he has no choice, because this is an organization that has come to him in his legacy, and he has to build upon it. So yes, there's a big difference. Some would say the Shiv Sena is morphing into a more gentlemanly party, but some would also say that a gentlemanly Shiv Sena does not morph.
It's not so much the numbers, but leadership credentials that evade Uddhav. Somewhat like Akhilesh and Omar. The Sena got 18 MPs in the Lok Sabha, not 63 MLAs in assembly, but still could not manage a respectable seat either in New Delhi or at the state. Uddhav lacks the political savvy and stamina to take on the BJP's clout. Instead of waiting for the BJP-NCP alliance to fall on its own contradictions, Uddhav kept changing strategy and ended in a tame surrender to the BJP when he joined the state cabinet without the portfolios of his choice.
When the Sena-BJP talks failed, it was quite clear that Uddhav's challenges had multiplied, because now he was under attack from two forces. In those circumstances, electorally, Uddhav Thackeray has done well, because I think 63 MLAs is much more than most people thought he would get. He focused all his energies on attacking the BJP in Mumbai, Thane, Pune, and it has paid dividends. But it is very clear that he is ceding ground to the BJP. And now, in the circumstances in which he has joined, the BJP show that he has agreed to accept all the terms given to him. Forget CM-ship, even deputy CM-ship has not come to him. So that, I think, is a major blow to the Uddhav Thackeray-led Shiv Sena. I personally think that he will have a lot of challenges in the next 2 years, especially before the Bombay municipal elections.
Also, the inheritance in terms of character, which is a factor that he shares, as it were, with Akhilesh, is that the Balasaheb legacy is very different from the Uddhav legacy as Uddhav sees it, or Uddhav strategy as Uddhav sees it. Uddhav doesn't want to be seen as somebody who is in that rough and tumble of bully boy, lion of Maharashtra kind of thing. He recognizes that those days are numbered, and the young of today are not probably looking at the same kind of maverick macho that Balasaheb portrayed. Also, physically, there is a huge difference in the demeanor that Uddhav shows. So I think that it's an inheritance which is still to mature.
Well, that's also a matter of perception, because politics is something that is not everyone's cup of tea. All four of them, or at least three of them definitely, are foreign educated, were westernized in their thinking, would rather be doing something else. Uddhav Thackeray also is a professional photographer, pretty good photographer. So they may not have the same motivations. It happens.
So there you have it, the League of Careless Inheritors. No doubt they're still fairly young and certainly cannot be written off just yet. But the moot question really is, how long will they finally start delivering consistently on their powerful legacies? But from us, that's all this week. Thank you for watching Cover Story, and we'll see you again same time next week.